Hello, I welcome you all in this module of Formation Water Characteristics as Oil Exploration Leads. I, Parthavatim Chakraborty from Department of Geology, University of Delhi. I will be discussing with you that how formation water that helps us in different kind of exploration activity for oil. After studying this module, you will be able to know about necessity of studying oil field water, definition of free interstitial and oil field brine, learn about different classification schemes that we use in the classification of oil field water, and the different graphical methods that we use for representation of complex chemistry of the oil field waters. We will also be able to understand how study of oil field water help as a lead in hydrocarbon exploration and repairing of a damaged well. Now, in most cases, sedimentary rocks are deposited underwater and hence are inherently water wet. Thus, irrespective of composition of sediments, water becomes an integral part of any sedimentary unit as it occupies its pore spaces within the sediment. In course of burial and diagenesis, much or all of this entrapped water either get altered in composition, get partially displaced by other fluids such as oil or gas, or are expelled altogether. The water that oil or gas is able to displace is referred to as free water. However, waters held in the very narrow and fine pore spaces are known as interstitial water, and they resist displacement by other fluids because of its high capillary pressure of the very narrow pore throats. As such, interstitial waters comprise 10 to 40% or even more of the total pore spaces that is present in a sedimentary, clastic sedimentary rock. Each water-bearing formation contains water that is chemically different from waters in other horizons. Hence, the chemical quality of formation water in an oil and gas-bearing region is very important for exploration and exploitation in an area. During exploration for oil gas, the composition of formation water can depict if a favorable trap is available and whether that would contain oil or gas. While the confined oil gas traps contain only connate water, some traps in general, shallow traps in particular, may come under the influence of fresh water, technically what we term as meteoric water. In this case, the flowing meteoric water may result in the flushing of oil gas and also it may cause the decomposition of the oil and gas. So the presence of meteoric water, which is generally oxygenated and cause degradation of oil, that knowing that presence of that kind of water, it becomes very important for any further exploration program. Also, during exploration of an oil or gas well, if suddenly water starts flowing or the well starts producing water, a chemical analysis can depict and tell from which horizon it is coming. This is the most important reason for oil field water analysis, as it helps both in identification of the water source horizon as well as repairing of the damaged well. Now we come to the sum of the premise before we discuss the detail of the field water. That is the oil field water analysis. Chemical analysis of oil field water is carried out by the use of methods that is standardized by American Petroleum Institute API, and commonly oil field waters are analyzed for 5 major components, that is calcium, magnesium, chlorine, bicarbonate and sulfate. Content of another cation, that is sodium, which is common in oil brine, is identified by means of differences, as it is difficult to analyze on regular basis. Now it is known to us from basic chemistry that each element or radical has its own combining weight, that is to form NaCl, 22.997 grams of sodium reacts with 35.457 grams of chlorine, no more, no less. In fact, the sum of equivalent weights of cations must equal to the sum of equivalent weights of anions. The equivalent weight of an ion is obtained by multiplying the actual weight of an ion, that is expressed in milligram per liter, by its valency, and then dividing the product by the atomic or the molecular weight of the ion. For formation water analysis, it is advantageous to express the analysis in milliequivalents per liter because equal numbers present equal combining weight. Now this is the equation we follow, that is milliequivalent per liter, that is actually the product of mg per liter, it is multiplied by valency, and that product is divided by the molecular weight. In analytical results from laboratories, concentrations of cations and anions commonly are mentioned in terms of parts per million by weight. For our understanding, it is preferable to express the results in terms of milligrams per liter, and how we transform the milligram per liter, that is by ppm by density, that gives you the idea about milligram per liter. We assume that the three anions, that is chlorine, bicarbonate and sulfate, constitute nearly 99% of formation brine, and contributions of other anions such as iodides, bromide, carbonate only minimum. In some rare cases, we can have some influence of this, but overall that influence is very less. Similarly, it is considered that the cations, or the positive ions, the major contribution is that of sodium, calcium and magnesium. However, this is often not true, as it is reported that many formation brines are also rich in potassium, strontium and barium. But their analysis is done separately. Now coming on to the how the oil field waters, they are classified. They are basically classified under different schemes. First, I discuss the genetic classification scheme. On the basis of origin and subsequent history, subsurface waters are classified into three classes, that is meteoric, conate and juvenile. Normal seawater contains 3.5%, that is 35,000 ppm dissolved solid, whereas most oil field brines contains much more solid in dissolution, that is as high as 300,000 ppm or more. Commonly, formation waters with total solid content, that is 10%, that is 100,000 ppm, are referred to as brines. Now, meteoric waters are those which presently form part of the hydrological cycle or remain part of it in recent past. They include the oceanic water, water evaporated in the atmosphere, water in rain and snow, surface water, and groundwater in motion. Chemically, meteoric waters are characterized by low concentration of dissolved solids, usually less than 10,000 mg per liter. Meteoric waters are rich actually in the bicarbonate, that is HCO3 minus ions. Coming on to the conate water, the word conate basically means born with, that is water remains of original sea in which the sediments were deposited. This is only partially true, as compaction of sediments expel large amount of pore water deposition is trapped within sediments. Immovable waters held by high capillary force within fine pores and water released from clay minerals in course of diagenetic recrystallization add on to the conate waters. As such, buried waters which remain segregated from the hydrological cycle for considerable period of time in geological past are referred to as the conate waters. Chemically, conate waters are very saline, containing 20,000 to 250,000 mg per liter, that is total dissolved solid, that is TDS. They are high in chloride, but bicarbonate is scarce or absent. Sulfate content is also limited or absent in these waters. Now, what we call the juvenile water? Waters that have ascended from the mantle to the earth and have never taken part in the hydrologic cycle, that are referred to as the juvenile water. However, juvenile waters are hard to identify, as most waters escaped from volcanoes are groundwaters which are vaporized by the hot lava. Water from hot springs and geysers, they are not juvenile waters, but meteoric waters which on percolation through fractures got heated up to the high temperature and depth, they are also sometimes referred to as the juvenile water. Now I come on to the discussion of the chemical classification of formation water. There are two schemes of chemical classification of oil field waters, that is on the basis of salinity and alkalinity and depending on the dominant mineral ions present in solution. Now we first discuss about the classification that is on the basis of salinity and alkalinity and proposed by Palmer in 1911. It is defined that strong bases, that is sodium, potassium, are combined with strong acids, that is chlorine and sulfate, to form primary salinity, and the strong bases are combined with the weak acids, that is bicarbonate, to form the primary alkalinity. Further, combination of weak bases, that is calcium, magnesium, with strong acids, chlorine, chloride or sulfate, forms secondary salinity, and combination of weak acids, that is bicarbonate, with weak bases, that is calcium, magnesium, form the secondary alkalinity. This scheme of classification lost its luster since combinations of ions as proposed in the scheme do not take place commonly, and it became hard to relate different water classes to their history and geology. Now, the other scheme that is also in operation, that is on the basis of dominant mineral ions present in the solution as is proposed by Sulin in 1946. Under this scheme, waters are distinguished as of four major classes depending on the distribution of three cations and three anions, as is discussed in this tabular form. You can see that we have taken on the left hand column, that is meteoric and conate. Meteoric waters, they are of two types, that is sulfate sodium and bicarbonate sodium, and conate water, they are of two types, that is the chloride magnesium and chloride calcium. And all these different four different types of water, they have their distinctive sodium by chlorine ratio, sodium minus chlorine by sulfate ratio, and chlorine minus sodium by magnesium ratio. So based on these ratios, that what are the different ionic ratios present, we categorize these waters into four different types. Two of them belong to the meteoric water category, two of them they belong to the conate water category. Now most oil field waters belong to type D, where sodium is present as cation besides magnesium and calcium. Chloride is almost the sole anion. Formation waters of this type are found in deep stagnant basins in continental interiors, where surface waters have no access to the formation. Type C waters characterize evaporite bearing sequences. In contrast, meteoric waters, that is type A and B, contain sulfate and bicarbonate, but very little calcium and magnesium. Sodium is the sole cation. These water types are found in near surface artesian conditions. In particular, waters containing bicarbonate and sulfate are oxygen bearing, subsaline, and in some cases almost of fresh water character. Now if it is assumed that sodium is the only cation present, then the sum of equivalent percentage of anions must nearly equal sodium. That is the equation that is shown, that is sodium that is equivalent to chloride, sulfate and bicarbonate. So if I subtract chloride from sodium, that becomes equivalent to the sulfate and bicarbonate. And hence the ratio, that is sodium minus chlorine, that is divided by sulfate, if it is less than 1, waters are classified as type A, that is sodium sulfate. Whereas if the value comes more than 1, the water is classified as type B, that is the bicarbonate sodium. In both cases of water, the NaCl ratio will be more than 1. Now in case of conate waters, which do not contain the sulfate or bicarbonate, and thus the only anion present is chloride, and hence the entire amount of chloride will be balanced by the all cations, that is the sodium, calcium and magnesium. And if I subtract the sodium from the chloride, then it becomes equivalent to the calcium and magnesium. And hence the ratio, that is Cl minus Na divided by Mg, if it is less than 1, then the water is classified as type C, that is chloride magnesium. In contrast, if the value of Cl minus Na by Mg comes more than 1, then it is type D, that is the chloride calcium. However, in both type C and type D, Na by Cl value, that always remain less than 1, as we have seen in the meteoric water, that always remain more than 1. Under this scheme, waters are thus classified also by graphically. the Na minus Cl difference that is measured in milliequivalent is plotted up if it is positive and down if it is negative. Further, if the difference is positive, the magnesium is plotted to the right of the origin. If it is negative, the sulfate is plotted to the left to the origin. So plotting of a number of water samples that is shown that some are plotted in the sulfate sodium field, some are plotted in the chloride calcium field, and you can see that the Cl minus Na that is plotted up and the Na minus Cl plotted down, the sulfate is towards left and the magnesium is towards right. So this is a typical Sulin classification of oil field water, and based on the ionic concentration and the way that we classify the waters, if we plot those, then those plotting that basically shows that where my formation water that falls within this diagram. Now we discuss the application of water analysis data. Now for any geological purposes, as an exploration lead, it is often advantageous to show water analysis data on map, preferably on the isochore map. The most popular method for plotting of chemical analysis data of water samples, that is by the steep diagram. In steep diagram, the chemical data in milliequivalents are plotted on a logarithmic scale, and hence there is no zero. Any value that is less than 1 milliequivalent, that is considered as 1. And cations are plotted in the diagram to the left from the center on 3 or 4 lines, and anions are plotted on the right. The plotted points are then connected by straight lines, and the polygon thus formed, that often either colored or blackened, and we call that the steep diagram. Now this figure illustrates the different shapes of polygons of different steep diagram from different kind of water, either it is fresh water, the sea water, the oil field water, or you get the different kinds of the solution, that is 0.1 normal sodium chloride or 0.1 normal magnesium chloride. So basically the way what we do, that is the lowermost, the row in the middle, what we showed, that is the how we plot it. You can see that all the cations, they are plotted towards the left, and all the anions, they are plotted towards the right. And accordingly, the concentration that in the milliequivalent, you plot the waters and then get the result of the diagram. Now, I will end my discussion with a application that how this kind of data that will help in our exploration program. For better understanding, let us assume two water analysis data of two different oil fields, while water 1 is a typical Conet water and water 2 is a meteoric water. And then how is that? The data that is being shown in the table, that what meteoric water and the Conet water. So water 1 and water 2. And if you plot that in the steep diagram, you can see the distinct difference in the polygon shape, that when you have a Conet water which has a very high chlorine and the sodium, and whereas a meteoric water which has a bicarbonate that is high. So these two are the distinct shape of the polygons for the two different kinds of. I also want to discuss with you about the plotting of the steep diagram on a map and how we interpret it. This is a map which shows the water quality data that are plotted on the map based on the different steep diagram on the different parts of the map. If you see that although the reservoir strata is concealed in the subsurface in most parts of the map, its exposures can be seen in the western and southeastern flanks of the map. While in the western flank, it exposes at an elevation of 3200 feet. In the southeast of the map, it exposes at an elevation of 1200 feet. As wells drilled in the central part of the map, it yielded water. It was assumed that the water enters the outcrops in the west and then issues in the east. The water analysis data from the area did not support the above conjecture. It is noticed that the water quality in the eastern part of the map is different from the western water quality in the western part, and hence it is presumed that the waters from the eastern and western part of the map cannot be components of the same hydraulic system. This gave birth to further high resolution exploration in the area, and it was found that the reservoir strata is lenticular in character in the western part of the map, although it becomes permeable in the eastern part. Further, it was ascertained that the water enters not through the reservoir strata but through the cavernous limestone strata. This limestone subcrops on the unconformity that is overlain by the reservoir strata. Now, limestone water everywhere is high in the bicarbonate, sulfate and calcium, while waters from the reservoir strata in the eastern part of the map are chemically similar with limestone waters. In western parts of the map, in the map, reservoir waters are rich in sodium and chloride and low in the bicarbonate. So water analysis data thus provided the lead for exploration and helped in understanding the reservoir geometry and delineating a subsurface unconformity. This is figure clearly explains that what I wanted to explain, that initially it was explained that the entire reservoir is continuous from the east to western part, but when the water analysis was done, then it was found that the two, from the western part the sandstone and from the eastern part the limestone, they have a different relationship in the subsurface, that is an unconformable relationship. And water is basically entering from the western part through the cavernous limestone, and this is coming out through the eastern part through the porosity of the sandstone. So if we summarize what we discussed, then we summarize it like that on the basis of mode of occurrence, the subsurface waters of oil fields are broadly classified into two categories, that is free water and interstitial water. Interstitial water is also referred as irreducible water, as it cannot be replaced by any other fluid such as oil and gas in course of subsequent diagenetic history of sediments. Oil field waters contain varying concentration of inorganic salts. Waters containing more than or equal to 100,000 ppm total dissolved solid are referred to as brines. As such, oil field waters are alkaline and strongly reducing. Genetically, subsurface waters are classified as meteoric, conate and juvenile. Meteoric waters differ from conate waters not only in salinity but also in chemistry. While meteoric waters have high concentration of bicarbonate and sulfate as anions, in conate waters, chloride represents the major anion along with sodium as major, if not sole cation. Steep diagram is an useful way for graphical representation of this complex compositional variability of subsurface waters, which often helps in terms of exploration and exploitation. I hope you have enjoyed the discussion on formation water and have understood the role of formation water study in any kind of hydrocarbon exploration process. Thank you.